Welcome everyone to this video, both the believers and the unbelievers, those of little faith and then those of great faith. Welcome to this video, and you know, you can see it's going to be quite an auspicious video. My role is to say the things that others aren't willing to say. And this time I have a history going back in many lives of standing up and trying to do what's right in spite of cultural pressure. And we're looking at someone right here who certainly epitomizes that. We're looking at St. Jude. We're going to talk a little bit about this great, great saint. And I will tell you right off the bat, he's back. All right, he's back. He's part of this return of Jesus to this world. And I've seen him. So this is another, I talk about the parade of elephants. I say, what I mean is those divine beings, meaning those who have stopped pretending that they're not divine. We're all divine. We're just pretending here. We're the ones. We're still pretending that we're not divine. Okay. But someone like St. Jude, he's not pretending that he's not divine anymore. He knows that he is, and we all are. So, welcome to this video. It's going to be quite extraordinary. And for those of you with great faith, it's going to be very helpful. So, I'm willing to say what needs to be said. I don't have any friends to lose, you see, in this world. It's helpful. I don't have any friends saying, oh, don't say that. You know, you might lose my friendship. I don't have that. I don't have any friends to blackmail me. So, and I don't have any stock in any company. I don't have any investments anywhere. So I don't have anyone controlling me, saying what I can say and what I can't say. This is a very good blessing for the world, actually. Now, Saint Jude is making his presence felt. And maybe there are some who don't know much about Saint Jude, or probably don't know enough about Saint Jude. And I didn't know enough until I looked up some more tonight. I do have a history with Saint Jude, but another indication happened tonight. And I said, wow, I have got to look this up. I have got to see what's going on with St. Jude. So I have a number of pictures here that I can put for you. Prayer to St. Jude. Now, I was praying to God one day, and I was really just desperate. I was so desperate. And I just said, God, please give me a sign that you're going to help out, because this just seems overwhelming. The difficulties we're having here, it just seems so overwhelming. So overwhelmingly difficult. And so I got out of my vehicle. It was a dump. And I didn't change. I'll change the light on this a little bit. And I've been praying. I said, wow. I said, the first thing I see, God, just give me a sign that you're going to help out. Give me a sign that we're getting help here. I'm so desperate. I stepped out into the muck and the mire and the garbage and everything. And there at my feet was this, I saw something colorful. I saw something sitting there. And I said, just not sitting there, just lying there. Trash. I said, what's this? Let me go pick this up. I picked it up, and it was this card. And I looked at it, and let's see if we can, it doesn't really, let me show this, let me see. There you go. Well, I got the light on it properly. Okay. This is a holy card. And I read, and it says, San Judas, rega por nosotros. It's in Spanish. Somebody had thrown this away, and it was sitting there in the dump. Kind of like how I felt, being tossed, thrown away, and left in the dump. And I said, St. Jude, I'm going to rescue you from this dump. You're coming home with me. So I brought this card home, and I put it, I decided recently to put it up by my desk there, so it's right there. Now, I say I have a history of St. Jude because I went to the, there's a huge cathedral, you might say church, but it's huge in San Francisco dedicated to St. Jude. And one time I went there and lit a candle. I was really desperate. So desperate. I've been through so many desperate times in my life and still am. But I went there and it was really extraordinary how many people go there and the candles that were there. I mean, St. Jude has a. He has a large following. Many, many people pray to St. Jude. Who is St. Jude, though? Right? Who is St. Jude? What is this? So let me fill in some of the spaces here, some of the blanks. To start off, let us just say that St. Jude is a heavyweight. He is a heavy, heavy, heavyweight saint in the Christian tradition. More than we realize, I believe. He's very close to Jesus. His uncle, St. Jude's uncle, was the Holy Father Joseph. So St. Jude's father was the brother to St. Joseph. Okay. The father, well, the husband of Saint Mary, okay, the husband of Virgin Mary, Saint Joseph, is and back then was Saint Jude's uncle, and the Virgin Mary was his aunt, and his mother was Virgin Mary's cousin. They were cousins. His mother was named Mary, and she and the Virgin Mary were cousins. So there's strong family ties with Saint Jude and Jesus Christ. Very strong. Jude had a brother named James. Both of them were apostles, original 12 apostles, okay? He was with Jesus, walked and spent all this time with Jesus. He was also at Pentecost. When the fire of the Holy Spirit came upon those gathered at Pentecost. And then he became this great evangelist who he became renowned for his international ecumenical travels, where he traveled just so many places, from Turkey to Persia to Iraq to Syria to Libya. He was a Armenia. He's credited for starting the Armenian church. He did so much traveling to so many different lands. He's also renowned for bringing the image of Edessa to the king, to a king. And this is this gold medallion that Saint Jude is often shown with. I will get a better picture of that for you. Is the image of Edessa, which they said Jesus imprinted upon a cloth. It's this gold medallion here. This is Saint Jude is shown with this because Saint Jude brought this gold medallion to the king and cured the king of a terrible affliction, saved his life. Now, there's the gold medallion you can see. You can also see in Saint Jude's hand a long wooden staff, which is about 6 feet long. He's usually shown with this, plus a green cloak. Okay, a green cloak. Here's another picture of Saint Jude. Okay, there you see the staff and the medallion with the image of Edessa, it's called. Okay. So we're filling in some of the blanks. We're talking about someone that had close family ties. His uncle was Jesus's, not biological father, but what we call it. It's his father, Joseph, father by marriage to Mary. Okay, so his uncle Joseph, say Uncle Joseph, Aunt Mary. That's how close he was. Now, the story about Saint Jude, and he was martyred. He was martyred. He was captured by some pagans ultimately and died for his faith in Jesus Christ. But what's interesting is his father, which is the brother of Joseph, Saint Joseph, was also martyred because he was insistent that Christ had risen from the dead, and that he insisted this is a fact, and he was profoundly professing this fact. And the authorities seized him, and he wouldn't renounce this. So he was very outspoken, vocal about Jesus Christ. So his father suffered martyrdom rather than renounce what he was saying. So we're talking about someone who is extremely in the inner circle of Jesus Christ, and who, now, there are those who claim that Jesus Christ didn't exist, okay. Well, we do know that all these apostles existed, because there are records of them and their travels and all what they did and the churches they established. There is massive, massive, incontrovertible evidence of the apostles, and they started all these churches, this huge wave of Christianity. That's incontrovertible, completely. And the apostles all say that they were there at Pentecost, and they all say what happened. They were with Jesus. So you'd have to be an absolute fool to claim that Jesus didn't exist. These apostles walked and talked and lived with Jesus Christ. They were related by birth. Saint Jude was related by birth. Jesus was his cousin. He was a first cousin of Jesus Christ. Okay? And he went all over the Middle East area, in Africa, all over there, proclaiming the gospel and saying, indeed, this all these things did happen, and performing miracles as all the apostles did, and bringing about tremendous number of healings. All of this is recorded. This is history. So to say that Jesus didn't exist, never existed, is foolish beyond any measure, really. It's an absurdist stance. It's to be caught in absurdity. It's to be a denier of history, really. Extreme denier of history. And it's the people who do that, they just do it for their own amusement, actually. It's entertainment. It's a form of entertainment for them, you know. Who can I play with? You know, who can I play with their mind? And yeah, they like that. Like lawyers love to argue, and that's their form of entertainment, right? Say, well, let's say, you know, let me take this position, you know. We don't have time for that foolishness, that kind of entertainment, all right? We have better ways to be entertained. So, St. Jude, now, going forward with Christian history, he was a forgotten apostle. He was the one who was most forgotten. Why? Because historically, people confused him with Judas Iscariot, because Jude could be also rendered Judas. Judah is, you know, is a very popular Jewish term. He was Jewish, and Jude is short for Judah, and Judas also is short for Jude, I believe. So there became this confusion between him and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed Christ for silver to the zealots and the Sanhedrin, etc. He sold them out for money, and then apparently went and hanged himself, is what they say. So there became this confusion, and people stopped praying to him, and he lost favor in the history of Christianity. And this went on for a long time. He was neglected. He is called the neglected saint. And then there was Saint Bridget and Saint Bernard had conversations with Jesus, and Jesus told him to pray to Saint Jude, that he's very, very powerful and is super willing to help out everyone. He's just a tremendous saint, and pray to him. So people began praying to Saint Jude in Spain and Italy, and it went to South America and eventually United States, but early 20th century, I believe, in Chicago. It's been a building movement. It's been something that's been growing. But what St. Jude is known for now is that being the neglected saint, the neglected apostle, that he has a very acute understanding of what it's like to be overlooked and neglected. And he is the patron saint of desperate and hopeless cases. The patron saint, he's the saint of last recourse. When nothing else has worked and people are absolutely desperate, they say, I've just been completely overlooked. Saint Jude is the one that they go to. Because he has this very strong connection with being misunderstood, unfairly treated, misunderstood, people confusing him with someone else that shouldn't have happened, being neglected, over. He gets it. He really, really gets it. But in his time as an apostle, he was an absolute world beater, you know, and super close to Jesus Christ. A very, very important Christian saint, powerhouse of a saint. However, he has this great compassion and understanding for those who seem to be overlooked in this world and left out, and nobody cares about them at all. Nobody cares. So this is the saint that Christians go to when they feel that this just nobody cares. There's no visible means of help arriving to me whatsoever. I'm just at the end of my rope entirely. They pray to Saint Jude, and multitudes of those who have prayed to Saint Jude have received great help from him. Multitudes. He is known as an extraordinarily responsive to prayer and helpful. Now, you've heard of St. Jude's Hospital, I think. Danny Thomas started that. He was helped by St. Jude, actually. He started St. Jude's Hospital, I believe, somewhere in Tennessee. Memphis, Tennessee? Memphis in Tennessee? But I think Memphis, Tennessee. I think it is. It's now be called St. Jude's Hospital, spread all over. And they take these children and treat them for free who have severe illnesses, desperate situations. They give them free, and they have the parents have these children have cancer, severe problems. They have, don't have money. Maybe they, you know, they're having trouble making. They say we're desperate. We're in St. Jude's is there. They can take their children to St. Jude's Hospital. So this is a connection that a lot of people are aware of St. Jude. But I don't think that we are aware of what a powerhouse St. Jude is in other religions, who have their great, you know, divine helpers. He would be seen as someone very, very significant and powerful and helpful. Tremendous amount of grace. So this is not some lightweight. This is a heavyweight. A big, big heavyweight, St. Jude, actually. So I have a connection with St. Jude, being myself severely overlooked in my life because I was willing to say things that people thought that I was being too audacious, and they turned away from me, and are still doing so, because I'm willing to tell it like it is, and most want a lot of absurdity in their life to act as blinders so they don't see it that way. They don't want to look at it that way. Now, I was getting the oil changed, my oil changed, and I was sitting outside. I didn't want to sit inside. There were some yoga girls inside, and I said, I'm going outside. I'm not going to hang around this atmosphere. You know, the know-it-alls were in there. And I went outside, and I saw this one man, a vagabond, come by. And I just noticed that, huh, what's that's interesting, this very odd-looking person. And he went one way. Then I saw the strolling down the sidewalk past me, this other vagabond, which is very unusual. We don't have vagabonds here. It's very rare to see such a thing. But this one struck my attention, really. It struck me. Just sort of subconsciously. Now, I've said this before in another video. I'm going to reiterate it here. It's very important. I guys watch him, say, oh, another vagabond. I said, I was trying to figure out, where are these people going? Where are they coming from? Where are they going? What is going on? There's something that wasn't quite normal about what I'm seeing here. And he had this long wooden staff, exactly like, I'll pull up a picture here. Exactly like this staff that St. Jude is holding. It's about, there you go. You see this, the staff here is about 5.5 feet high or so, or maybe, I don't know how tall St. Jude was. Let's say a 5-foot staff. This man had exactly this wooden staff, the same length, the same time, it was exactly the same. And what he had it over his shoulder. He had it over his shoulder like this. And he had this green sleeping bag. You know how you pack a sleeping bag? You kind of fold it, one half fold it, make it a little narrower, and then you roll it up. He had the sleeping bag all rolled up like that. And then he stuck his staff through the middle of it. So he had a staff over his shoulder, and then the sleeping bag was stuck through the middle of the sleeping bag was stuck through the staff and resting on his shoulder. And that's how he was walking. Okay. Green sleeping bag. And so I said, that's very unusual to see someone with just this real neat long wooden staff. You don't see that here. It struck me as very unusual. But then I looked at this person and their dress, and they were immaculately dressed. And I looked at the shoes. The shoes were like brand new, really nice, brand new shoes. And he was his hair. He had a beard and hair, somewhat short hair, cut hair. He looked neat, clean, presentable, like he's, you know, just this. No dust on his dirt or dust on his clothes or anything. And I said, what kind of vagabond is this? This is someone that he has every impression of a vagabond. That's all he's got with him, is just a staff and a sleeping bag. But he shows no evidence of any vagabond duress whatsoever. Sharp dressed man. And he looked fit as a fiddle. I mean, he looked very, very fit. Lean, strong, fit. No drugs, you know, no trouble. This is a very confident person. So I was watching him. Yeah, I just thinking, hey, what is this? What is going on here? This is something very out of the ordinary. I was trying to figure out, why is somebody who could be driving a Ferrari, why is he walking around with a sleeping bag and a wooden staff like this? Like he's a vagabond. He travels from town to town somehow, you know, he's just, what's going on here? And he had nothing else, no backpack, nothing else but the sleeping bag. I thought that struck me too, so wait a minute, you know. You don't often see vagabonds with like this, with just a sleeping bag, nothing else. No water bottle, no backpack, nothing. Green sleeping bag. So we're driving home from church today, and we see this pickup truck come up on the right lane. And I noticed it, and I noticed right away the wheels, something, they were all white. I said, oh, white walls, look at that truck. I'm noticing, oh my God, look at that truck, it's very unusual. And then we stopped, and I was able to get a closer look, and the hubcaps were all white, and the rims themselves, the rims were all white rims. But it actually wasn't white wall tires, it was white rims with these beautiful white hubcaps. It gave an extraordinary effect, and it was this old International truck. Really old and solid, but the bed was lowered down somehow, and I'd never seen a truck quite like it, actually. And we were commenting on how solid that truck was and powerful. And what was the color? It was this color green, very, very strong green. I said, wow, that's an unusual color. And suddenly it struck me while I was watching that truck. I said, hey, wait a minute. Isn't St. Jude's cloak green? Doesn't he wear a green cloak? Isn't that part of his symbology? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Clothed in green. International, this truck, international. Man, St. Jude was a man of international travel, an apostle who was renowned for his international traveling. He went to all these nations, okay? And this was old style. This truck was, I said, that's old school. That truck's really old school. But I said, it's a really good truck there. Yeah. St. Jude's old school, right? He's an apostle, Christianity. He's a man. He's an apostle of miracles. That's old school, right? These days, Christianity's tending to kind of like, you know, trying to distance themselves and just say, "I just do good works. Just do good works." You know, don't hope too much in miracles and all this kind of stuff. But faith in miracles and all this. Vatican II has kind of changed things, but he's like a pre-Vatican II. He's old school. This truck was old school. It's like pre-Vatican II truck. It was. So I rushed home. I said, I gotta look up St. Jude. And I said, oh yeah, he has this green cloak. It's a very similar color tone. Then I looked him up on the internet, and I found out he is Jesus' cousin. First cousin with Jesus. First cousin. Nephew to both Joseph and Mary, and Joseph's his uncle, and Mary's his aunt, brother of the apostle James, international apostle spreading the gospel to a tremendous extent, patron saint of Armenia, said to have founded Christianity in Armenia. So he traveled far and wide. International traveler. Now, I have been saying for quite some time that I believe the saints, and expanding this to all traditions, we'll just say the saints, but the blessed ones of all traditions are going to start reappearing in this world. Because I've said Jesus has already come back. He came back last spring. We're coming up towards that anniversary, actually. He said, I'm back. And I'm here to relate with you as a friend. That's all he said. But I had the feeling that he is not going to come out and have an appearance so we can see him walking around in the world yet. Not yet. First are going to be some other saints that are close to him, that don't have so much baggage attached to them, don't have so much shock and awe. I mean, if you saw St. Jude walking around, you'd kind of say, oh, who's that, St. Jude? Oh. Looks like a nice man. Let me talk with him. You know, if you see Jesus, it's a whole different story, right? So this is a way to ease into it. And I said there's going to be this parade of elephants. I say, well, sit back, enjoy the parade of elephants, meaning our siblings, in our spiritual siblings who realize that they're divine. We just are pretending we're not. They are no longer pretending they're not. They're now realize that they are divine, truly divine. And they, when you realize you're divine, it's easy to appear here, to have an appearance here. You can simply appear anywhere instantly. Not only that, you can appear, have multiple appearances in all sorts of different places simultaneously. It's easy. So it's easy for St. Jude to appear here in the world. Piece of cake for him. So I am saying that man that appeared, walked down the sidewalk like that, and acted in a way that was guaranteed to catch my attention. And I just happened to be sitting out on the road, which I never do. It is just I didn't want to sit inside. My truck is getting the oil changed. And I was just watching and taping. I was actually taping at that point. I was taping the tape recorder and really making a big effort. It just happens this man shows up very conspicuously odd if you take the whole picture into account and you're very, very keen on looking at it. I said, this is something doesn't add up here at all. I'm saying that was St. Jude. I'm saying St. Jude has already shown up in the world here with an appearance. And he's not the only one. Chandra, I said, the great Dakini Chandra Tsering Chodron also showed up to me, showed up. The spiritual consort of, I'm having a hard time now. Yensi, Choki Lodro, Yensi, Choki Lodro. It's hard to remember those Tibetan names. I'll get better at Yamjang. Something like, yeah, the great spiritual master of the 20th century of Tibet. His very close disciple, showed up. So that's two already, I'm saying, that showed up. St. Jude and Chandra Tsering Chodron have shown up, have made appearances here that I'm aware of. Now, these are, you know, for me, it's like, wow, this is great. This is really amazing. But I can handle that. I can handle that. All right? But this is a process we're undergoing, that we're getting ready for the heavyweights to show up. The heavyweights are going to show up here. But when we're ready for it, Now, this full stop in the wow practice is supremely helpful to help us with this. Because when we have this experience, we just say, okay, wow. Just full stop in the wow. That's it. We're not thinking about one way or another about it, or what to do, what to figure out, what to analyze, what to organize, what to arrange, what to project, what to recall. None of that. Just what to think. No. Just full stop in the wow. And then we prove to ourselves, I can remain calm. My mind can remain steady. Okay, this doesn't unnerve me at all. Well, but it's pretty powerful that Chandra Tsering Chodron was very powerful, because her laughter, her peals of laughter were like divine laughter, and it rocked my psyche. It really did. She says, what are you doing practicing? What is that? You don't need to practice. Keep practicing, you keep missing. Stop practicing. No practice, no problem. You know, this is the ultimate Dzogchen teaching, really. We don't need to perfect anything. Just look at our own perfection. Let the mind just look at its own perfection. So I'm saying St. Jude has already made an appearance here. Is it just coincidence? Is it just coincidence that this card, when I was praying desperately to God to send help to me, I need some sign of help, that St. Jude would show up at a garbage dump, you know, this card where you can't, it would show up at a garbage dump. There you go. Right when I stepped out, right after that prayer. And is that just a coincidence? Is that just a sheer coincidence, huh? Okay. Then this figure who looked very much like this, okay, his hair, his beard looked very much like this picture, very much so, would show up like this with a staff, exactly wooden staff, exact like this, with what looked to be a sleeping bag rolled up. But, you know, it could have been this green shawl rolled up also. It could have been that. But the likeness to St. Jude was extraordinary, and the circumstances were extraordinary. Now, St. Jude is known for the Novena of St. Jude, which is praying for 9 consecutive days. Very powerful prayer. Now, many traditions have had many miracles from the saints. This is a prayer to St. Jude, some script. I'm not sure what the script is. Well, Christianity is no exception. Christianity is a history of miracles, actually. You want to describe Christianity as a history of miracles. And in modern times, St. Jude, you'd have to say he's the heavyweight. I don't know what other apostle. Well, the Virgin Mary, of course, is a heavyweight for various reasons, the Catholic Church sort of just made up all sorts of doctrine in the 19th and early 20th century, and Assumption, co-redemptress with Jesus, all this stuff, Assumption into heaven, they made up all this stuff. It helped them with their bureaucracy and institution. But anyway, so you could say that she's a heavyweight, but you would say among the apostles, okay, St. Jude is very, very well known now. Because we're in a desperate situation right now. It seems to be the lost cause in this world, doesn't it? And those who have of faith are feeling very, very isolated and overlooked in society. Again, throughout all traditions, saints have shown up. They've shown up. Even after they've passed away. After they've passed away, they have shown up. And that they've made appearances here in the world. It's actually easy for them to do so. But they don't do so because it unnerves people. So what I've done, I've trained myself to not be unnerved by it. Okay? I've put in a lifetime of effort, because I knew it was going to happen, to not be unnerved by this when the saints start showing up. They're going to show up. Because this is what's called the end times. This is a huge change, or absurdity is doing a makeover, a huge makeover. And saying, yeah, this other absurdity didn't work, but that's because the style wasn't right. We've got to change the style. Now this style of absurdity is going to work. You know, this definition of God is going to work. That other one didn't work. Got to change who's in control. You know, change the whole thing. Just massive change to try and define God. You know, this is our great spiritual arrogance, the great sin. Trying to claim that perfect freedom can be defined as something specific. Definition. Definition, it means specific, some sort of specific. Freedom is just freedom. That's not a specific. It's freedom is we can experience anything we want to experience. We're not bound. Reality is not bound. It's free. So that truck was unmistakable. You could not miss that truck. It was quite extraordinary. And the medallion-like hubcaps is very reminiscent of this medallion that St. Judas is carrying. And the white and green motif is the same motif of St. Jude. The tunic he's wearing is the white, and then the green contrast here. If we can get this to come up. Oh, maybe maybe that's the one. Let me pull up this one here. So you have the white tunic with the green. That was the exact color motif of this international truck. Powerful truck. Old, but still running great. You see, old, meaning hearkening back to old times, yet still viable, and yet overlooked now. This style completely overlooked. St. Jude. Very powerful symbol of St. Jude. Now, I'm forgetting one thing, but I will tell you this right now. I'm in the previous video, two videos previous to this, I have this interaction where there's some young people come over here, and the older one is named Jude. Yeah. Just came by the house, and then later he came back again and was very kind, and I hoped that, you know, they weren't causing any noise to interfere with the recording. I said, no, it's perfectly fine. So Jude returns a second time. Just sheer coincidence here? Okay. Well, you know, those who believe in sheer coincidence are deniers of synchronicity, or synchronicity deniers, you'd have to say. Synchronicity deniers, which is people talk about climate change deniers. Well, being a synchronicity denier is even more, you know, that's really bizarre. You know, being a Jesus denier too, that is beyond bizarre. They're just doing this for their own amusement, actually. Maybe they're bored. When you start getting synchronicity like this, powerful, powerful, unmistakable synchronicity, you better pay attention or you're a fool. Now, I did not know of how central St. Jude was to Christianity, to Jesus. I did not know this. I really didn't. So it came to as quite a shock to me to find out that he and Jesus are first cousins. Close first cousins. And his dad is the brother of Joseph. St. Joseph. Holy cow. Uncle Joseph, Aunt Mary. Most likely he spent time at Jesus' house when Jesus was growing up. He lived in a very, very close area of Galilee to Jesus, actually. So it's almost a certainty that he's played with Jesus as kids. They spent time together, you know, doing what children do. Grew up together. Very likely they grew up together. So you talk about someone of great faith, you know. In Christianity, St. Jude has to be put up very highly as one of the top saints in Christianity, actually. You know, seriously, I'm looking at this. The more I look at this, I say, wow. I was not aware of that. You know, we Christians think like, well, St. Mother Teresa, okay, that's a great saint or something like that. We forget about the apostles. We think, well, they're dead and gone. And you know, no, they're not. No, they're not. You want to talk about greatness in Christianity. You could hardly do better than St. Jude. You know, some people say St. Paul did a lot, okay, which he certainly did. But he was not related that as closely to Jesus as St. Jude. St. Jude was right at the heart of it. He's right at the heart of it, of all of it. So, St. Jude is a miracle worker, and many, many, many have attested to this. He is a real miracle worker. He has the grace of God and the capacity to help out in ways that we don't understand. And he's back. He's back. He's here. He is here. He made an appearance. In my estimation, he already made an appearance. Showed himself. Just to let us know, hey, Jesus is back, and I'm back with him. And if Jesus came back, you would think that St. Jude would be one who would accompany him. That's how close they are. Makes sense, doesn't it? He's part of that close to that holy family. Absolutely, very, very close. Could hardly get any closer, really. Now, most people say that Jesus had a brother named Luke, and maybe other siblings too. But that is not the Luke in the Bible. The Luke in the Bible is, I believe, a Greek physician who was not actually an apostle. Okay, he was the only evangelist who was not an apostle. Matthew, Mark, and John were apostles. I think John was like maybe the only apostle that wasn't martyred, actually. So these apostles refused to renounce their faith, even though they were going to be murdered, basically. I mean, martyred. There's no possibility of them renouncing their faith. They said, what I'm telling you is true, and I'm not going to renounce the truth just to save the life of this body. I will not do it. That's the kind of certainty they had. So for me, appearances of all blessed beings are welcome, all right? I don't make distinctions between denominations and traditions and all this. No, they're all welcome to show up. Now, I will say I saw this man at a gas station that was a splitting image of Rana Maharshi, and I did a double take, and I just said, what the heck? I thought it was him. And he just walked by, walked into the gas station, then walked out, and for a minute, I thought, that's him. He's back. So that was a shock. But these things are good. These shocks are good, very helpful, because they're preparing us for greater and greater involvement and help from these blessed ones who have dropped all pretense that they're not divine, okay, that they're not perfect, that they're not God being God. They've dropped that pretense. And so they know who they are, and they know who we really are too. They know who we really are, and we are truly divine. We're just pretending not to be. It's an arrogant pretense of absurdity. It's just absurdity, arrogance and absurdity, which has now got continuity fear, fear of the abyss. If we stop trying to define God, all this causes us great trepidation, so we keep pretending. Just because we're stubborn and persistent pretending doesn't mean it's real. Just because someone persists in pretending doesn't mean it's not pretense. Okay, this is very important. There's some people who might pretend not to be able to speak, or pretend to be someone else, or to save their lives. They might go into some heavy pretense, and they might keep that pretense up their whole life and refuse to stop doing it. Because it was important to save their life at some point, and they think, I got to keep doing it. If I stop doing it, something terrible might happen to me. That doesn't mean it's not pretense. It's still pretense. It's still pretense. Absolutely it is. So we're pretending to be mortal flesh. We're not. We're not mortal flesh at all. St. Jude knows this. St. Jude knows this. He can make any appearance he wants to anywhere. And he's making it very clear to me. I can feel it now. That I'm back. I'm back. Expect something. Expect something now. He is putting on the grace. His grace is coming. Is into this world, and it's growing. It's growing. It's very much growing. It's a live situation, you might say. It's heating up. And this is what we should have expected. I have expected it all along, that in some way we're going to have this extraordinary time called the Parade of Elephants. The ancient ones who have dropped all pretense, they're going to come back. And it started. It's already started. And that means the pace will pick up. The pace will pick up. And so I go to bed, I wonder what's next. Tomorrow, I don't know what's next. But, get your attention. Maybe you will see someone that you know is a saint. Say, wait a minute, that looks very familiar to me. Who is that, actually? Because they can appear in anywhere and just fit right in like they're just someone walking down the street. In any guise they want to. So they just see it, there's another person walking down the street. Then you say, wait, do a double take. Wait a minute. Was that reminding me of someone? Was that? No, that can't be. Wait a minute. It'll get your attention, like in some way. Just say, who was that really? Who is that really? So they could be peering all over the world now, just as casual citizens. Absolutely they can. And I believe they are and will continue more and more and more to appear in this world like this. Attention getters. They're getting our attention, because this is the most crucial time in history, because absurdity is about to make this huge makeover, a stylistic makeover of this notion of defining God. And we don't want to get caught up in this makeover. It's going to be very thorough and very severe makeover. Okay, it's still going. We don't want to get caught up in this. We want help. We want freedom from this. And so many people pray to St. Jude. He's very much prayed to, in especially in Catholicism. I invite Protestants to go to Catholic Mass, and Catholics to go to Protestant services, and even evangelical services, to start smoothing out their positions and becoming more ecumenical. The Protestants need to realize that total reliance on the Holy Spirit and Jesus, the continuity fear, I can feel, is creating a barrier there. It's like It's not easy to approach Jesus Christ because of the stature, you know. It's a lot easier to approach someone like St. Jude. More approachable. These great super heavyweights. There's a lot of awe connected with them. And I find that Protestants distance themselves from, even though they pray fervently to Jesus, like, but they're keeping defensiveness. There, they keep defensiveness. They always say, "Well, yeah, but not quite now. Not now. Not now. Not now. It's happen going to come real soon, but not now." And you can tell it's too much. I mean, it would be too much for me at this point, I would think, if Jesus were to appear, you know, despite all preparations. I think it would be a little bit premature. I think it would be too much. Wow. Too much. Wow. So they think that they can handle just being in the presence of Jesus like that. If Jesus was to appear, walk the earth right now, walk the earth, which I believe he will do. We will appear here. I don't think that they could handle it as well as they think. So they might want to think about praying to the saints. Yeah, let's start with St. Jude. He's showing up. Let's say, "Hey, St. Jude, we're happy that you're here. Show up more. We'd love to see more of you." Absolutely. It's wonderful to have a brother like you, brother in spirit. Absolutely wonderful. So show up as much as you like. And then even more than that. You know, start, lower your expectations a little bit. So there's more reasonable, more pragmatic. And get used to that first. And then St. Jude will say, "Oh, yeah, I'm Jesus' first cousin. I know him very well." You know, that itself is a very profound connection, right? And so let's get used to that first. Let's get used to that first. And that's a nice stepping stone, isn't it? Very nice stepping stone. I feel we could handle this. I can handle this. I can handle St. Jude. I mean, I could feel comfortable with that. It's like, but yeah, but still, wow. I mean, he is absolutely part of one of Jesus's, you know, closest operatives, you know, saints. There's no question about it. So, great to know St. Jude. And I think the Protestants could get some help going to Catholic Mass, and Catholics get some help going to Protestant services, really. Now, I go to Catholic Mass. I'm not a Catholic. I'm ecumenical, everything, so I can't claim to be anything in particular. But I just don't take the Eucharist. I just go up and cross my arms like this, and then they bless me, do a sign of the Trinity on my forehead and bless me. I just say amen. I've been doing this for years and years and years. That's not a problem at all. No one has given me the slightest second look at all. In fact, they treat me very, very nicely, very kindly. And there are plenty of people who go to Catholic Mass who don't go up to take the Eucharist at all. They're there with their spouses or their friends or whatever. They just go to enjoy, to experience it. And the Catholics actually invite everyone. You don't have to be Catholic to go to Catholic Mass at all. You don't have to be at all. Nobody will cause you any problem whatsoever. They will not. It's a little different when you go to a Protestant service. Is they welcome you at the door and, "Oh, you, I don't know you. What's your name? Are you a friend of so-and-so?" It's like a family, and you kind of need to have some connections to even go there. I get a little nervous when I go to Protestant services because they kind of like pull you into their family, and you may be saying, "Well, I'm ecumenical. I mean, just a super ecumenical. I don't. That's what I'm like." But so, whereas Mass, nobody says a word. Nobody's ever said a word to me. So it's very easy. But the Catholic tradition is a great tradition in spite of all the slander and troubles and sabotage and mistakes on their part. And it's all a big ball of wax. But it's a tremendous tradition. So it's very foolish to just cast it aside, because you're casting aside these great apostles, these great saints. Saint Jude stacks up with some great bodhisattva, for instance, in Buddhism, all right, or a great guru, a rishi in Hinduism. St. Jude has the same kind of stature. That's the kind of stature he actually has. And they wouldn't think of tossing, a Buddhist wouldn't think of tossing aside someone of that stature. But yet Protestants, they, don't seem to pay any attention to any of these great saints. Well, I mean, you might want to, reconsider that. And same hand, I love their emphasis of the Holy Spirit and Jesus. They do a fabulous job, and they don't, they honor the Virgin Mary. They honor Saint Mary, Virgin Mary, Saint Mary, but they have it in right proportion. It's not all blown out of proportion like in Catholicism. So I mean, they do a lot. Protestants do a lot of things right, but they have de-emphasized the great saints to a large extent. But Catholics do not, they've de-emphasized the Holy Spirit and over-emphasized the Virgin Mary to a great extent. I noticed that so much in Catholic services is the Holy Spirit's rarely mentioned. The priest today talked about, he said, yeah, I forgot to mention God and Jesus. He's talking about some assignment he once did. And I said out loud, yeah, you forgot to mention the Holy Spirit too. Remember, God's a Trinity. It's not just God and Jesus, it's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And they do this routinely. They leave out the Holy Spirit, but they almost always include the Virgin Mary. Well, let me tell you, the Holy Spirit is more central than the Virgin Mary by an infinite amount. Okay, the Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity. You don't leave the Holy Spirit out of Christianity. This is just insane. But they're very lax about that. Shockingly lax about it. And yet they include Virgin Mary in everything. You know, just pray for us, pray for us, pray for us, pray for us. Well, hey, how about Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ? I mean, get the Trinity going, for sure. But if you got the Trinity going, great. Then a close super apostle like Jude, why not also include Jude? Why not? I mean, what's the objection? I can't see any objection at all. What could possibly be the objection about Saint Jude? He's just a very dedicated, super compassion. In Buddhism, they'd call him like a super bodhisattva. He's just a fabulous bodhisattva, someone whose whole purpose is to help us, to help all those who are in need. That's what his focus is. He's super service oriented, compassion oriented. So he should be given his rightful due. He absolutely should, and the Catholics do give him a lot of due. Although I've never heard him mention in Mass, hardly. No, I really haven't. However, he's back. All right, he's showing up. So all praise to those who've shown up. We have at least four great teachers: Jesus, Longchenpa, Ramana Maharshi, and Anandamayi Ma, who have shown up in terms of, on the inner planes have shown up, the Sambhogakaya, the inner planes, the Holy Spirit, so to speak, I have not seen them in a physical appearance here, although I did see someone who was a splitting image of Ramana Maharshi, but they've shown up with the inner empowerments very, recently. So they're very much part, the game is on as far as they're concerned, very much so. And I believe they will show up here physically as well, with a physical appearance as well. They will do so. And yet it will be some others first that we will recognize, and we'll start getting used to it. We'll just get used to it, and we'll say, okay, this is what's happening right now. Okay, this is what's happening for us. This is what's happening. The saints are returning and showing up. And so we just get used to it. It's like skateboarding started, and 62, 63, whatever. Okay, skateboards start showing up all the way. Before that, there was no skateboards on the side. Never shown up. Nobody knew what they were. And suddenly these kids were showing, you know, skating down the sidewalks on their skateboard. People are looking, what the heck is that? But gradually it spread throughout the culture. Now, there was a time when the kids were just all over the sidewalks until they were banned. You know, unfortunately, they were banned. They're kids. So let them have their fun. I'm not really for banning everything, you know. I mean, talk to them, educate them. They'll get it. You know, most kids are good kids, and they understand. But let the kids have their fun. You don't see many skateboards around anymore. I was driving home, Friday, and I was thinking about that song, Sidewalk Surfing. I said, I think that's our theme song here. And suddenly there's these four kids skateboarders, and they skateboard right across in front of me, the street, and one of the kids stumbles and wipes out, and he kicks the skateboard, and the skateboard goes rolling right back across the street right in front of me, and I had to slow down and stop, and he went running back to grab it. And I said, wow, there's the sign right there. What an incredible sign. I said, definitely pick up that skateboard theme, because this was a fad that just came out of nowhere. And yet it became this great subculture, right, of skateboarders. I was part of that, the early skateboard scene, very much part of all that. Then later on, I never went to skate parks or anything. That came later, all these skateboard parks and all the fancy stuff and the half pipes that they do and, you know, all these amazing stunts and flips they do. It was just incredible what the skateboarders do now. They're really something else. I never did that. But was one of the pioneers. We made skateboards. I had a lot of skateboards. And I skated down the sidewalks. I did all that stuff early on. And people say, you know, what's that? What's that? What's that? So we see saints walking down the sidewalk, sidewalk surfing. See? Sidewalk. Both the saints have shown up on sidewalks. Both Chandra Sering Chodron and St. Jude have shown up walking down sidewalks. That's exactly how they showed up. Sidewalk surfing. Grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. To number 22, Janvary. He says, pay attention to number 22. Pay attention. I'll put a link to that video. I got to start linking to that. 22 means the return of Jesus Christ in appearing here in this world. Actual physical appearance here. If you look at the symbology of it, actually, it means divine manifestation as an appearance here, concrete appearance here in this world. Of course, Jesus knows his appearance only, can dissolve that appearance instantly. Just a mental projection. So Jan Berry was saying, hey, 22, 22, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming. Get ready for it. Sidewalk surfing. These saints are walking down sidewalks. So pay attention. Pay attention that I believe the saints are going to be walking down sidewalks in this world. You just see someone walking down a sidewalk, and you might say, holy cow, this person looks very different. There's something about them. And so you become a part of this sidewalk surfing culture. This new culture that is aware of the return of the saints. And for you, you get used to it. And you say, oh yeah, I'm used to it. Whereas others, they're not. They say, what is that? You know, what? Just like seeing a skateboard for the first time. Who is that? You know, little old lady from Pasadena sees the skateboarders going down her sidewalk. Says, what in the heck is going on? Never seen it before, right? Now, you might have seen somebody skating on skates down the sidewalk, yeah. But this, what is this, board? And they're going, what? But they got used to it. Everybody got used to it. Everybody got used to it. Became part of the culture. So you have to start somewhere. And we're starting. We're already starting. I'm pioneering this here. The saints are returning. They are appearing here. They are appearing. Walking down sidewalks. And you'll start noticing them if you're willing to notice them. So again, I'm saying something that seems so outrageous to most, you know, they just like say, oh, it's completely, utterly ridiculous. It's not ridiculous. Not at all. This is something I've been told to prepare for. It's going to happen. Get ready. Be very spiritually prepared for this. Full stop in the wow enables us to handle the shock of this. It's the shock absorbers. We're like shock absorbers for the world. Cultural shock absorbers, actually. Because we're not going to just go into some another absurdist matrix claiming to define God. We're not going to go into that. We're through with that. We're through with that. We're going to a reduced intensity zone where we're going to walk back that whole absurdity. We're going to walk back the absurdity. We're going to walk it back. Okay? Reduced intensity zone is made for that. So we give thanks to St. Jude for showing up and asking St. Jude for help in all directions, because we're getting trouble from all directions. So I'm not going to give any specific prayer. I'm saying help us in every which way. You know, it afflictions upon us from every angle right now. Help us in every which way. I may start, you know, put up a website with the ones who are starting to appear. Who's appearing for us now? And so we'll start paying attention to it. It's got to start somewhere. And, you know, people laugh at me, they scoff. This has happened my whole life. You know, just you know, what a ridiculous thing to say. Who in the world does he think he is saying stuff like that? Well, I came here to say stuff like this. That's my purpose. That's why I came here. I'm capable of doing it. I mean, if I wanted to get back into music and play the piano and put myself to that, I would have been a virtuoso again. And people would say, how in the world can you be such a virtuoso? Well, because I've already done it. Yeah, but I don't need to do it again. This is more interesting to me. People ask, well, why aren't you being a virtuoso and composing music? It's because I did it. I've been there, done that. And this is way more interesting. The return of the saints and Christ here is way more interesting to me than just being a virtuoso, piano virtuoso. Come on. I mean, let's get real about it here. That's a no-brainer. Maybe I'll do that in some other life if I want to. It's fun. It's nice. Be able to play the piano, you know, and music, and if you do it well, it's enjoyable. Sure, it's absolutely very creative, very enjoyable, but it's nothing compared to this, the intensity of this situation. This has a very vast scope to it, and it's designed to save so much suffering from so many. For so many, it's a very huge mission of compassion. You don't want to get hooked into another, these cycles of absurdity, where there's a massive makeover, and then you think, well, I can't really judge it. You know, I'll have to see how it turns out. You know, this is nonsense. Absurdity, all absurdity is equally absurd. There's nothing to judge. You don't need to waste any time at all judging absurdity. It's blatantly absurd. You just go right to the root. It's all blatantly absurd. So you don't need any cycle of thinking, oh, well, this is the way to define God. And there's no definition of God. So saying this is the way to define God is completely absurd from the get-go. It doesn't matter what the style is. It makes no difference. It makes no difference whatsoever. So all praise and glory to you, St. Jude. Thank you so much for showing up. It brings tears to our eyes that you haven't forgotten about us. And you're in full blast mode here. It's go time. The ones who show up at go time, we have great love for it, really. Absolutely. You know, the ones who show up in a crisis, those are the ones, you know, those are the heavyweights, okay? This is the world's in a supreme crisis right now, so the ones that show up, we know that these are the real wonderful heavyweights showing up. It's a litmus test. Yeah, it's a really profound litmus test, isn't it? I made that huge plea for compassion, the universal plea for compassion, for help. I said, I don't care who it is that shows up. I don't care if I don't have to know you, nothing. I said, but just please, if you want to help out right now, please, please, please show up right now. And that's that very night Longchampa showed up. I didn't know who he was. You know, he said, I'm here. You know, you got it. I'm here. I am here. Let's get it rolling, you know. He showed up. He absolutely showed up. Answered the bell. Answered the call. I didn't know who he was at first. I found out pretty quickly, but still I didn't realize the extent of it. If I had known who it was, I would have been too shocked. You know, so it's a benefit. Ignorance in that case helped me out greatly. I said, someone showed up. I don't know who it is, but I like them. They made a great entrance, that's for sure. But if you know, so anyway, I've just gone over that many times. So there's someone that shows up, right? Answers the call because they can. Because they're focused on compassion, helping us out. They know we're divine. Okay, and so to see the divine caught in this pretense that they're not divine and have a great fear of stopping this pretense, this, you know, their heartfelt feeling is they want to do everything possible to help us drop this pretense because they know that we're absolutely equal with them. There's no difference. And they know the glory that they're experiencing. They know that we truly want to experience that glory again as soon as possible, and we want to be free of this dreadful anxiety and affliction, mental afflictions and such. And they know we're suffering terribly in this way. So in every way, they're in our corner. And in the same way you would be to a beloved sibling, you know, seeing them like go through some hideous cancer or something. I mean, you want them to get well, you know, in the strongest possible way. Someone you care about so much, you're in their corner 100%. No back down whatsoever. Absolutely backing them up in every way. Well, multiply that times, you know, infinity, so to speak. And that's how much these great teachers are in our corner. It's just we can't quite see how they help us out. You know, we're not sure about it, and we're ambivalent about it too because our continuity fear. So we hope, well, don't help us too much, you know. We're afraid of the abyss, so we're afraid of that. So we say, don't help us too much. So, but they are 100% in our corner. Longchampa showed up right away. Didn't hesitate. Showed up right away from that degree. It was the strongest prayer I've ever made, and it was just an ecumenical, open prayer, and he showed up right away. Because he could tell I was serious. I was absolutely serious, and he responded the seriousness of it and says, okay, you want help? I'm here to help. Let's get it rolling here. And he has. He's been very helpful. He's done a tremendous job already in furthering all of this. Super helpful. And I'm just saying that they're these great teachers. I just put them in this echelon that nothing can be said about them, really. There's no way we can define how great they are, how helpful they are. We just cannot define it, okay? So don't try to, you know, draw comparisons between Jesus and Ramana Maharshi and Nanda Maima and Longchampa, for instance, Buddha or Shankara or whatever. Don't try to draw the distinctions because their helpfulness and their compassion is beyond any definition. It's beyond anything that we can measure. It's immeasurable compassion. So why try to measure then? Just leave them in this top echelon. Immeasurable. immeasurably helpful. All these teachers are immeasurably helpful. There's no limit to their compassion. That is true. No limit whatsoever. No restrictions, no limit. It's just pure, pure, pure. 100% pure. You can't get better than 100% pure. So we have to stop trying to one spiritual one-upsmanship. Or, you know, my teacher's better than your teacher. Or, we're special. 100% pure is 100% pure. Immeasurable is immeasurable. Undefinable is undefinable. And just say, this is just top echelon. However you look at it, however you want to slice it, it's top echelon compassion. So we'll take it. I mean, you know, I'll take all the compassion and help I can get right now. Because this world, the way I see it going, it's just a crusher. It's gonna crush me. Just brutally crush me if I don't get help. And so beggars can't be choosers. Let's not be choosers here. We're beggars right now. We're begging for help. You know, let's not be so picky and choosy. This is just arrogance. And let's not get hung up on labels either. Who cares if somebody gives a different label to the same thing? It's the same water. Are you not going to not drink water? Somebody calls it agua. You know, here, have this agua. What? I can't drink that. I can't drink agua. I only drink water. What are you talking about? This is, you know, whimsical on our part. Water is water. If you're thirsty, drink it. Doesn't by any other name, it satisfies our thirst the same. So I'm absolutely thrilled that St. Jude is helping us. Absolutely thrilled by it. Just as I'm thrilled that Longchenpa is helping us. Absolutely thrilled by it. So this ecumenicalness is helpful. We need help from all directions right now, because this trap is hitting us from all directions right now. We are under duress from all angles. And it's going to become exponentially worse very soon. Now keep in mind that this great Dakini Chandro Sering Chodron, I didn't know who she was when she showed up. I had no idea, and I only stumbled across her. I looked up on the internet. I looked up great Dakinis or something, not knowing it had any relation to what had just happened. And there was her picture, and I saw the picture. I said, "Oh my God, that's who was walking down the sidewalk, and who laughed at me when I was doing practice swings at a golf tee." I said, that's it, the sunglasses, the hat, the attitude, everything. I said, oh my gosh, I didn't know ahead of time. I think it's Yamjang, Kiensi, Choki, Lodro's spiritual consort. Or Jamyang. I could look it up. Just bear with me here. I'm under a lot of duress and inspiration, etc. I didn't know ahead of time. So you might have an encounter, and later on you see a picture, and you say, oh my gosh, that's who it was. In the dream of Ram Maharshi, he came to me, and I didn't know who it was. And later I saw a picture on the internet, and I said, oh my God, that picture is exactly who it was. I knew instantly that's who it was. It was Ram Maharshi. I knew it was some incredibly great being, but I didn't know at the time who it was, really, in the dream. And then later on, I realized, oh, that's who it was. Oh my gosh. No wonder why there are so many people following him. Yeah. So you might have encounter with some great, some divine being, some blessed being, and later on you find out, oh, that's who it was. Okay? Absolutely, that happens. So the more we get used to this, the more we can take it in stride, the more helpful we can be to others. Because they see that we can handle it, and they say, oh wow, if they can handle it, I can probably handle it too here. If you see people skateboarding early on, you say, oh, they can do it, maybe I can do it. So kids saw other kids doing it, they said, hey, let me try that. So we need to have this kid-like attitude, young, like a seven-year-old, and just think like, yeah, I could do that, let me try that. Not all hung up on cultural norms. We got to get off the hang-ups of those cultural norms. Like, you can't, what are you talking about, saints reappearing? You're crazy. Say, no, let me try that too. Maybe I can recognize some saints that have come back and get used to that, because it's happening. It's going to happen. And then one day Jesus will be walking this world, actually. And you want to be ready for that. And don't be humble and say, maybe I might have some troubles with that. Maybe I'm not quite ready for it. But let me see if I can find a way to prepare for that. Because when Jesus said, I'm back here to relate with you as a friend, and I saw him brought, he gave this proclamation to the entire world. I saw millions and millions and millions of people. I saw this, the whole population of the world was there. And he said, and he was waiting. Anybody wanted to do it. And I saw a few kind of start trying to raise their hands, and I couldn't quite raise their hands. They were struggling, and I sort of tried to raise my hand. So I saw there was a few here and there scattered around who were kind of saying, well, maybe, 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 maybe. But no one was actually raising their hand. And I was in the maybe mode too. I said, wait a minute, we can't have Jesus shut out here. This would be a scandal and a disgrace for us here. Absolute disgrace. And so finally, I like, I raised my hand and said, okay, I'll do it. And Jesus said, great, okay. And then he said, come here. And we had a talk. We had a talk. So I said, I can't let him be shut out. This is terrible. But I noticed there were a few scattered here and there were, who are in this almost maybe mode. They're just not quite. They want someone else to go first or ahead of them, let's say. They want someone else to go ahead of them and make sure it's okay. Like, you're not going to be thrown in an abyss, are you? And so I went ahead. I said, okay, I'll do it. I think I can handle this. And it was pretty shocking. It's really intense, to say the least. Just like, oh my gosh, I'm talking with Jesus and as a friend here. Oh, he's just relating with me casually as just, brother. That's it. It's like, wow, quite an experience. So you can do it too, but you see someone else can do it, that, you know what, I think I can do it too. So there are those who will do it. There are those in this world who will do it. Because I saw there are some that are almost ready. And my job was get ready. Jesus kept telling me, hurry up, hurry up. You got to be ready. He put me on this very intense accelerate path. You got to be ready in time. To play your role and help break the ice here in this world. So that's what I'm doing with these videos, help breaking the ice. So this has been another ice-breaking video. Starting to get kind of late because we have this time shift now, right? The daylight savings, and I got to get up early. And so, all praise to the Holy Spirit first and foremost. And all praise for all those who are showing up now to help us and highlighting this video. All praise to you, St. Jude. We're greatly looking forward to everything that you do, assisting you in whatever way possible, or however we interact, or however it plays out. We're we welcome you with open arms as a great friend and a great spiritual sibling. And so, let's keep it simple, very simple. Remember, commitment to simplicity. Commitment to simplicity. I'll put a link to that song, Cyborg Surfer. Learn the song. It's very potent, actually, that what's going on. These saints are showing up on the walking down sidewalks. It's a very, very prophetic, potent song somehow. Jan and Dean, Sidewalk Surfing. There's a stereo version and there's a mono version on YouTube. In fact, I'm going to go listen to that song right now. All right. Grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. Very great. That's it for this one.